The views, comments, and opinions of the following program do not necessarily reflect those of Morris Media Studios, MorrisMediaLive.com, or its affiliates. Listener discretion is advised.
And come one, come all, as these sisters show you some people that's grinding and standing tall. Highlighting the struggle, as you're waiting patient just to make it. Debating your body aching, you're pacing for it to bubble. We all a village, so it's time to huddle. We gotta come together, empower us through the hustle. Yeah, and together we fall. So I'ma hold my brother and my sister up while we all on the come up. While we all on the come up.
The come up.
While we all on the come up.
You are watching on The Come Up. My name is Michelle Mitchenor.
My name is Jeanine Holcombe.
And I'm Quinnette Bramilli. As you can tell, Quinnette is not here today. She's out there being great in the streets yet again.
Yes.
So, of course, you know, she had to do what she had to do. But you will hear from her later. Don't you worry.
Don't you fret, my pet.
As you know, every week we are bringing you individuals who are trailblazing in their respective field. And what's so great about this season, what I keep thinking about is just the versatility we have of guests.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Who's been your favorite so far?
So far, I'm not going to lie, Major was good.
He had her in tears, y'all. Did y'all see that episode?
He broke me down. Major was good.
My dad called me. He was like, I really loved the Major episode. That was one of his favorites, too.
That was one of my faves.
The one with Mitch and Scott, our first one back, was really good.
That was good. Well, Ashley, that was a lot of fun.
That was.
She felt like she co-host girl.
Yeah, come through whenever you want. But how was your week, Jeanine? What you do?
It was good. I went to Palm Springs. It was nice when
you
I was
say like Palm Springs.
Palm Springs. And I got to see those little T-Rex, like little roadside attractions. Mm-hmm. That was a good time. Mm-hmm. I don't understand why it made me as happy as it did, but I enjoy seeing large pieces of plastic, apparently.
I don't know why that's so funny. I enjoy seeing large pieces of plastic.
I don't even think about plastic.
Yo, that is hilarious. I got to go to the Underground Season 2 premiere.
Yeah.
It was a really, really, really great show. I really just, like, the thing that I enjoy about the show is that they kind of, at first I was like, I don't know in terms of this, but now I like it because they add kind of, like, current music to it, and I'm like, but it's about, you know, during that time period. So at first I was like, I don't know if I can really get into this, but now I'm starting to appreciate it.
That's how I felt about, Great Gatsby. Like, remember how they put, like, they tried to throw, like, modern songs in the movie? It kind of threw me off for a little bit, but then when I went back and watched, I was like, all right, I guess it fits. Yeah. It was nice.
It was really cool, and I highly suggest everyone go ahead and check that out. It's a really good series, and shout out to Anthony Hemingway. He's a dear friend of mine. I've worked with him. He's a phenomenal director, and I wish them the best of luck on their second season.
It's going to be great. Tune in. Starts Monday, right?
I think the 10th.
I believe Monday.
We'll get back to you on that. But look, just go search Underground WGN on Instagram, and all the information is there. I highly suggest supporting that show. It's a great show. But speaking of filmmakers, our guest today is a filmmaker. He's from Chicago. He is a man of many, many, many talents. He has a lot of hats that he wears, but I'll let him do the talking. Everybody, welcome Geno Brooks.
Thanks for being here. You're in the building.
He's in the building, everyone. He's in the building.
Yes, yes, yes.
Thank you, Geno. Thank you so much for coming on the show. Absolutely. This is really special to me because those who don't know, Geno gave me my first acting job, like official acting job. And so he's near and dear to my heart, and you're very special to me and will continue to be as I continue to ascend through my career. No, seriously, that's a big deal.
Absolutely.
The first person I gave you know what I mean, a chance.
Yeah.
That's a really big deal. A lot of people be like, oh, Spike Lee put you on. Be like, yeah. I mean, he gave me some forefront, but my first job was with Geno Brooks. So I always appreciate you for that. Can you just introduce yourself a bit to those who do not know you, as well as give us three fun facts that even I don't know.
That you don't know.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, my name is Geno Brooks. I'm definitely from Chicago. I'm an alpha. I'm a husband. I'm a wife. I'm a father.
A wife. I was going to be like, whoa.
Sorry. I'm a father.
Those are the times.
Those are the things. I like to look at myself as a 360 filmmaker, somebody that kind of understands film from behind the cameras, from the thought concept, as far as like the idea, bringing it to the black and white, and being able to bring imagery to those words or those thoughts that I had however many days or weeks back before I actually got on scene, before I actually shot and directed the episode or a movie, anything like that. So, yeah. And then three things about me that...
make them fun.
Fun facts.
You might know that one. I cry when I eat.
I do know that one.
Cry when you eat?
Okay. Please share with the people this because it's the most... It's so weird.
It is weird. It is weird. But it is unique to me, and I've learned to like embrace it. And people that know me, may know that fact about me. But basically, if I'm hungry, or if the food is like delicious, and it's the dopest thing about it, it only comes out of my left eye.
So it's like one like little baby tear that's like,
yeah.
You got a glory tear.
Yes, he has a glory tear.
Exactly what it is, glory
so
tear.
Good.
So it's like whenever he's on set, when he has to be the actor, like it's just like, just give me like a cheeseburger
absolutely.
And I'm cool.
Absolutely. Make a little food before hilarious. I take my side. You do my coverage.
That's hilarious.
Like not like onions, like any food. Right, Cheerios. Right.
Cheerios.
And I get it in. So I look at it as like a ability, you know?
Yeah.
Great little fun fact about me. Two other things about me. I have a clothing line coming out.
Oh!
Yeah, it's an artistry apparel. It's called the Artrepreneur. It's for the...
The Artrepreneur.
Artrepreneur, yeah.
Artrepreneur, I like that.
Yeah,
can we get a shirt?
Or? Absolutely. Yes. And that's why I was telling Jeanine before I got, I was coming from my son's football practice or game, and I didn't get a chance to like change and put it on and bring you guys. So
I'll
definitely get it over to you. But it's for the working artist, if you will, the business minded artist.
Mm.
So that's what I call it, Artrepreneur. And then the other is I have a master's in rehab counseling.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I graduated from the University of Kentucky, so when the Wildcats win, I win. So I think that's pretty cool.
That's
it has
up.
Nothing to do with film, and I think, but I absolutely believe that it attributes and enhances my skill set as a director and as a writer. So
absolutely. You said rehab therapy?
Yeah, like rehab counseling.
That's beautiful, actually.
Rehab. So anything from like the mental... physical, that we also tap into like drugs and things that how it affects the body, like depression and things like that. So our job and ability is to try to counsel you through therapy, through whatever kind of therapy that you need, assess it, and help you through that.
So for like those like rehab, like little, not, I don't know what they're called.
It's okay.
Like those like communities for rehab.
Yeah. It's just, and the great thing about it is kind of like, it's kind of broad. So you're able to tap into like different things, anyway, from drugs to mental health.
Mm.
Yeah.
So you would be, so somebody in that position would be like the lead counselor or therapist at that rehab.
Yeah, basically like a treatment team, and that person would be the head person to kind of facilitate the resources to get to see whatever that individual needs, and come up with a plan, and then. That team puts together that plan and executes.
That's wonderful because I think that's essential in people who have like drug addictions or getting over anything, that they have proper counseling from somebody who's aware of what it is that they're going through.
Absolutely.
That's wonderful. I had no idea of that profession.
I think it's fantastic.
I think it's pretty cool.
I actually have an idea, but we're going to move on.
Okay, so usually we like to go ahead and start everything off a little fun.
Okay.
I'm sure you've had time to watch our fantastic show.
Absolutely.
Wonderful.
First of all, can I say something? I've known Michelle for a very long time, and like I told you, it's a pleasure to finally meet you.
5 years.
Finally, pleasure to meet you, and I know Q. But I remember when this was a concept.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? She ran it past me. I thought it was a dope idea, and I'm glad to see you guys like in season two, see where y'all are.
Thank you.
Appreciate
absolutely.
It.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
So you're I'm sure you're familiar with one of our segments called Cognac and Chit Chat.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so for those of you who may not be aware of what Cognac and Chit Chat is, so we're going to have a little fun. We're going to ask you a question.
Okay.
what you're going to do is, because we're going to go ahead and keep this family friendly when you're in.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to have something. Yeah. Michelle, too.
Michelle's
going to have some
orange juice.
Michelle's going to have some orange juice. I'm going to have a cocktail. Okay. So what you're going to do is you're going to ask you a question. Mm-hmm. I'm going to explain this in my best Q voice.
Usually this is Cornetta's segment.
You got to add a lot of elbows.
Okay.
I'm going to ask you a question.
Right, right.
And then what you're going to do is you're going to answer it. But first, you're going to take your drink.
Right.
You're going to pick it up.
Right.
You're going to swirl it, sip it, sit it down and answer the question.
Yeah, that's usually how she does it. I think that's pretty good.
That was good. Thank you. Thank you.
Especially with this
I'm open
part.
For booking.
This part is the thing.
You gotta do one of these.
Okay, now, but listen now. Before we get into our question, we're just going to play a little clip because it pertains to the question. It
segues into it.
It segues into it. Let's play that clip. Shout out to Sky in the booth helping us out today at Morris Media Live.
Sky.
This is a man's world.
Really?
Come on, Aisha. I'm just trying to finish up this last text to my assistant, okay? Can you please finish?
Okay.
You see, ladies, there are three ways to keep a man happy. One, give a man just enough space for him to miss you. Two, be able to cook. Ain't nothing like coming home to a hot meal. And three, last but not least, and my personal favorite, give a man a great blowjob. I'm talking about the kind of blowjob that makes you wet. But keep in mind, the best blowjobs are given by women who find enjoyment in it for themselves. You see, we can tell if you're just doing it for us, or if you're into it enough for yourself. That's all you should be concentrating on. So the last thing you should be doing is talking. You should have a dick in your mouth.
Man makes money to buy from other men.
Oh my God. We gotta take cover.
Wait, hold on, wait. I'm crying. Okay, wait a second. Wow. Let me get these ducats out. My ducats.
I had to take cover.
I'm not gonna lie. Joints.
Oh man.
I had to take cover.
Take cover. Hold on, wait. I wish there was a camera on Sky. But she was watching. Okay, listen.
Hey.
That was intense.
Ooh, all right, I'm back. I just had to. Okay. All right, so, okay, first, let's talk about that show, Mind of a Single Male.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Can you just, before we ask that question, what is that show about?
It's basically, it follows a guy that's been heartbroken. And what I wanted to do is, like, chronicalize his dating woes, him trying to get back on his feet after being left at the altar by his fiance. Mm. So, in many ways, this is him trying to mend his broken heart.
Okay. And you wrote this
Yeah.
piece.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, we have a question.
We have a caller.
Caller. Okay, let's see who called in. I guess it got really steamy, so let's see who's calling in. Hello.
Caller, you're
Hello.
On.
Hello. Hi, yes. This is Quinny from Philly.
Oh. Listen, you can always count. If Quinette is not physically here, she's going to make an appearance.
Oh, my goodness. What's up? What's going on? How you doing?
I'm good. I'm so sad I couldn't be there. Hey, y'all.
So, hey.
I miss your hair, Q.
Aw.
Yeah, I love your hair. Mm-hmm.
Thank just you. So, look, okay, I'm not quite sure what I just watched, being as though that I'm live streaming it.
Right, right.
Now, do you... Oh, wait, sorry. By the way, Jeanine, great introduction. It's all about the elbow. It's all about the point. And you nailed it.
Thank you. Thank you.
So, Mr. Geno, back to you, young man.
Hey.
Do you really feel like those are the three things... I'm not sure if you asked the question already.
No, we haven't.
Do you feel like those are really the main... three things
mm-hmm.
that a woman needs to do to keep a man?
Sweat,
like,
grab your drink.
Truly, iconically,
uh-huh.
grab your drink.
Swirl it.
Sip.
Is that the smell it? Ooh, it smells so great. Ooh.
Did I do it right?
You tried it.
I tried it. I'm ready for it, though.
Because you wrote it, so.
I did write it, yeah. And it's, here's the thing. I'm going to say yes, because what's happening is these are unfiltered thoughts from a man. You know what I mean? Even though sometimes you may get it when he's saying it to you, it's already been filtered, right? Mm. So when he breaks the wall, the third wall, and talks to the camera, he has no filter. He's telling you exactly what's on his mind and how he's feeling. And that was the approach for that season. So... in most cases, although many guys won't tell you that it should be something else, those are the things that they really feel.
Those three things.
Those three things.
Those three things.
Yeah. Keeping his belly full, you know, the last one, having that amazing ability, and then, you know, giving him enough space.
That ain't shit.
I'm saying.
Chicks out here doing the most for everything, and you said it's all I need.
They out here, look, getting degrees, being smart.
I'm out here trying to be smart.
You know what I mean? Being well groomed. You know what I'm saying? Looking good, dressing fly.
Keep my carpet clean.
Edges laid.
I didn't say top five. Those kind of come out first.
Right?
Y'all want her to have titties, ass. Mm-hmm. She gotta have long hair.
Contacts.
Yeah. I don't know about the hair. Jeanine making this short hair look good, so I don't know. Real quick. That ain't a need, you know. Personality is what it is. How about that?
Yeah. We forgot to mention that in his intro, Mr. Chase.
Yeah. I'm sorry, Chase. He didn't get to list five. He was able to list the top three.
So have you gotten, what type of feedback have you gotten from viewers who watched this? What is the response?
They love it. You know, the women are looking at it, you know, when that was the first piece that was out, they thought it was a little harsh. But once the episode started to roll out, they were starting to fall in love with Chase the character, and then kind of see him for who he is in representation of the men that they knew.
So what if a woman has, like, two out of the three? Like, let's say she just can't get that blowjob on, like, it's just not...
Right.
It's just not on point, but she give you that space she can cook a mean meal. And maybe, you know, maybe number three isn't her
maybe
her
thing.
Maybe there's other things that she excels in.
I think.
What do you think?
I feel like as long as the desire to please is there. Because if you give them too much space and your desire isn't there, then you're off. You're not connected. You know?
Now, out of those three, do you feel like one of them holds more weight? Like, what if her cooking is subpar? Like, let's say she got oodles and noodles and hot dogs down to a science, but that's her glass ceiling.
Only thing I would say is curve it a little, make it a little healthier. It was, you know, get it down to some, make it a good salad, green salad, some kale in there. But that head game is vicious. She's real.
Wow.
So here's the last question. What if the head game is on a bean? It's on 100.
Right.
She could cook her ass off, but she's always on your back. In your neck pocket. She wanna know what you're doing, where you're going, who you're calling, who you're texting. She wanna go to the party. She wanna go to boys' night.
Yeah.
She on your neck.
It depends on what kind of guy it is then. But me personally, I love to come home to a cooked meal and a nice head game.
Mm-hmm. I mean, well, you are married, and so I mean, I guess
you mean to tell me
generalizing that one too.
The perfect day for a man would be to have a boys' day, come home, dinner ready, and she like, baby, go. I'm about to just go ahead and
yeah. Or even after you get out the shower. We understand.
And give you a nightcap.
Here's the thing.
Put me to sleep. Oh.
So are you putting her to sleep as well, or is this just one-sided? Or? Hey,
I would hope that the guys out there do it. I know I'm an advocate of, you know, doing my thing. Yeah. Mm. You know, I definitely take care of myself and that person in the bed, and, you know. I've been blessed.
We might need to change the name of the show.
Right, it's getting a little steamy. Cornetta, how you doing? How's everything going?
I'm actually going to get up out of here so I can refocus.
Okay. Get up out of here.
We appreciate you for calling in, and we're so proud of you.
Calling.
Absolutely.
I love you.
And she'll be in next week to talk about what she was doing this week. Mm-hmm. Okay. Just give you more details on that. So let's get into some questions. Okay. Get you out the hot seat a little bit. Yeah, you want to take a drink just to quench your thirst after all that steaminess?
Damn, that joint. I'm not going to lie. That joint sent me for a loop-de-loop.
Yeah.
I purposely didn't watch the clip because I enjoyed Black Boots.
Oh, wow. Thank you.
Like, when I was in Korea, uh-huh. I was calling Michelle after every episode like, yo, what's up? What's happening?
Right.
Because I knew, I was like, this is going to be good. And then I saw the question. I'm like, let me go ahead and leave that emotion genuine and organic. And I'm glad I did, boy.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
And for those who don't know, Black Boots is a series created and written by Geno Brooks, who he gave me the opportunity to be one of the starring characters in, or lead characters in. And it's up on YouTube now. You can stream it. Just binge watch it. Take a Saturday afternoon and just binge watch. A lot of people are hopping on the Greek story.
Oh, man.
I ain't gonna say no names, no nothing like that, but a lot of people are hopping on the stories of pledging and such, and there's a lot of similarities based on what we've been doing. Yeah. But we're gonna leave that there because there's room for everyone, yeah?
There it is.
Shady boots.
So but Gino, when did you start writing and creating your own content, and where do you pull your inspiration from? Especially because you have such a variety of content out there.
Well, I started writing I've always kind of like long form wrote, you know, as far as like stories, but I was never like in a proper format. Mm-hmm. So I would say around 2010 was the first actual script that I put together. And then, of course, you get notes and fundamentals have to get better. So around 2011 is when I finally put together something that I felt needed to be produced. Mm-hmm. So since then, and then what inspires me, like, my first script was based on what I knew. I was, you know, like we was talking about my profession. It was drawn from the things that I, you know, The Therapist was my first web series, and it was drawn from some of the things that I kind of went through as a counselor and a therapist, and I formulated something around that. So now it's more about, I read a lot more now, and I get inspired by people and visuals. Like visuals is kind of like how I tell my stories. Before I even get to my script, sometimes I know how they're shot or how they're laid out, and then I just go back and track it and put the script together to match that.
Beautiful. This is that. I guess we have another call. All right.
Hey.
Really?
Let's just bring it on in.
Hey caller, hey caller, who's this? Hello?
Okay. All right.
Looks like
false alarm. All right. Well, call back. Please call back. I enjoy callers. We're gonna have to start making that a thing. Like, call in. This is a good time.
Okay. So, next question. So you're from Chicago.
Absolutely.
Chi-town. And we are all aware of the unfortunate violence that happens in Chicago and it being headline news. What do you feel like is a common misconception about Chicago?
That if you go to Chicago, you'll get hurt.
Mm-hmm.
That's not necessarily true. I mean, I would say you just have to keep a heightened awareness of where you are. And if you have, if you're not from there, ask somebody where you're from, that's from there, to kind of give you the guidelines on how to navigate the city. Mm-hmm. And other than that, I would just say that it's always cold there. It's never always cold. We got a really nice time during the summertime.
Do you think there's a reason?
There's nothing like summertime, Shaq.
Do you think there's a reason why the violence mm-hmm. may be higher than the national average in Chicago?
I grew up in the projects. Well, in my teenage years, I grew up in Stateway Gardens. If anybody knows from Chicago, they understand where that is. That's a South Side project between Robert Taylor's and the Ickes, or Ida B. Wells. It's like in a 4-point radius. And
Ida B. Wells.
Yeah. And growing up there, it was just like they had gang leaders. You know what I mean? If that makes sense, they had a hierarchy there. Mm-hmm. But then when the feds came in and knocked off a lot of leaders, took away a lot of the older heads that kind of ran the city and made gangs organized, if that makes sense, but it was actually organized. When they took them away, then it was left to the young cats to kind of navigate and run a city. And that's mm-hmm. why during the gang culture there, the shorties really don't have much respect for the older folks mm-hmm. because they're the one that's out there that's committing these acts. And I think, as crazy as it sounds, taking away the big heads or the old heads in the city kind of left the kids to kind of run wild. Mm. I think that's what started. Then the education and taking away like arts and all those kind of programs mm-hmm. Didn't help it.
Yeah.
Because a lot of those funds were facilitated, I'm assuming, for the prison system and county jails.
So they just took away a lot of those things as far as like music and art.
And that just leaves the kids with nothing to
Absolutely.
Do.
Absolutely.
That's unfortunate, man. That happens in every major urban city.
Yeah. So it's unfortunate. And then, you know, I definitely, once I get a little bit more notoriety behind my name, you know, I do plan to kind of give back in my own way. I grew up playing basketball and football. I was really decent in sports and everything that I played. But that's really all that I had. Mm. You know what I mean? Like, even with the arts, they didn't have what I was good at as far as photography and drawing. Mm-hmm. So my plan is to run a youth program where I teach kids how to write and direct and produce their own films. Mm-hmm. And I want to give that back to the city of Chicago, and I want to kind of duplicate that throughout the country if mm-hmm. possible. That's kind of my way of being.
That's wonderful. Yeah, bring the arts back to our communities, man. It's so important.
Yeah. Very important. So, Geno, you have a lot of actors in L.A., including myself, who got their first opportunity on screen with you. Can you speak on what is it that you exactly look for in an actor, mm-hmm. and how can they get to audition for you? Because I know a lot of people, because they know kind of like the trajectory of KJ
and you
and myself, yeah. and so many of us who are out here like on TV, they're like, yeah. well, where did they start? And they know that we started with you.
Yeah.
I know there's a lot of people who want to work with you.
That's a lot of, it's definitely
a lot. Shout out to Courtney Burrell.
Shout out to co-star. Yes, he's doing this thing right now. Everybody, Miles and Miles Greer.
Yeah, Miles, yeah.
Rich Williams. A lot of people are doing their thing right now. I would just say the first thing that I look for as far as somebody to lead my show or lead something that I kind of, my brainchild, I have to get into. So that's the other thing. People inspire certain characters. Mm-hmm. If I go find a talent like a Michelle, then I might already have a concept like a Black Boots. But most of the times, the story hasn't been tracked out. Mm-hmm. So once I find that actor to kind of inspire me to write for how I want to see their talents play out or something that I've already seen them kind of do, that helps me take that story and that character to another place. So a lot of times I like to try to find people before I even have a story tracked out. As far as like, you know, how to audition for me, I definitely put up, you know, the post on Actors Access, LA mm-hmm. Casting. So the typical ways that actors can kind of find these things, they can go that way. And if you see me in, you know, if you see me, it's not easy. It's not hard to just ask me for my, how I can send you my, send me your resume, your reel, and those kind of things. And kind of, I like to, here's my last thing to, I always ask him, like, what's your dream role?
Right.
Because most of the time, I can't afford a talent, you know, for the, is for their day-to-day time. So what I try to do is write for them to give them something that they're looking to kind of play out at this point. So that's kind of way, that's one of the things I love to kind of trade off for time.
And so you are approachable, though. So you and do you actually go through the submissions of people sending the headshots, sending the reels? Do you actually sit and watch them?
I do. I do watch the reels. And I'm here's the thing. Like, you know, I'm somebody, but, you know, I'm not to the point yet where I can't receive a genuine conversation out in the public, you know, if it's genuine. but I am... You know, my trajectory is starting to kind of go in a route that I've always dreamed of to happen for me. So it's that's starting to kind of fleet, you know. So I will say that, and I'll be honest. But there is a way to get to me and get your stuff over to me, and I do take the time. I write and direct, and I shoot most of my things. And I'm also, you know, producing other projects now for other individuals, not just mine, giving other creatives opportunities. So I can't say I can get back to you in 2 days. If that's what you're looking for, that's not, I'm not that guy. But give me the time and I'll get to you. You know, sometimes it just takes the time. Like when I'm working on a specific project, I might go to that pile of stuff that I'm working on. I mean, that I need to kind of get energy or inspiration from. And that may just be your reel or your headshot.
What's up? It's good to hear that.
What about for somebody who doesn't have any acting experience?
It's always a way to do it. And I'm not the guy, you know, it's a good chance that I probably won't allow you to lead a project of mine because I'm all about the talent. I'm all about the actor. And if it's not there, I would love to, the desire has to be there.
Right.
Somebody that's a hard, you know, what says a person like KJ and Michelle, aside from anybody else, they outworked everybody. Mm-hmm. I knew that they wanted it. You know, all I needed to do was be there and show up for them and answer any questions that they needed to, you know, as far as that character. But a lot of times people don't go home and do the work.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're not about that work, I can't, you know, I work too much for to kind of hand it to you. So, but I mean, it's always opportunities for people to kind of just be around.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm also offering, I got a couple mentees now that I'm, pulling along, if you will, allowing them kind of shadow me, because I have mentors that's doing it for me. So I was like, you know what, it's not too early to kind of start and kind of help a budding filmmaker or even an actor or actress that may just want to be around my energy or our energy at the company, and then we go from there.
Nice.
It's beautiful, man. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Especially as an actor. I mean, I didn't have like official acting credit. He just saw me in an acting class. So, I mean, I would like to say that he saw, you know, that, okay, this girl's working towards wanting to be better. You know what I'm saying? And I think a lot of times with actors out there, even if it is just a YouTube show, it is important that you treat it as if it is a network show or a cable show, wherever it is that you want to go, because there's not really that big of a difference from those different sets, aside from, you know, more money, more cameras, you know what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, the same type of like work ethic that it entails and focus and dedication is essentially the same. So if you're treating it like, excuse my language, but if you're treating it like it ain't shit, or if it's just like this little thing, then, you know, when the bigger things come, you may not be fully prepared.
Yep.
So I just want to.
I appreciate you saying that. If I could say something to that real quick, is that, that's the energy that I pick up off of too. When I bring somebody around the set, they're looking for something. They're looking for more lights, more crew, people to be around, because they're expecting something to be different or bigger, and it's not. Or they understand that it's a YouTube. I treat my network like a network.
Mm-hmm.
I have several shows. We roll them out fall, spring, summer, just like Foxwood or. Mm-hmm. BT would, you know, so I treat it exactly like that. And for somebody that can't grasp that opportunity, then there's a little room for them to kind of stay around and be around what we got going on. Because, you know, I had 5 network meetings last week, and that's all because of my YouTube channel and my ability to kind of push forward. You know what I mean?
All I'm saying is I'm happy I was in it first. So look,
it was a good show.
Hopefully, I know I got a shot somewhere down the line. Hello.
Somebody is on petty patrol today.
I mean, and vice versa. Shoot. Yeah,
absolutely.
Look, when I was broke in these streets. Anyway, moving on. Moving on.
Okay, so we're going to get into a little game.
Okay.
It's going to be called Name That Movie.
Wow. You call yourself a filmmaker.
We're going to go ahead and test your knowledge.
Wow. Okay.
Okay. So first one. So we're gonna say a line from the movie, and you have to say what the movie is.
Why do I have to be like this? I bet.
The fun continues.
Yes.
You gonna eat your cornbread?
I believe that is Baby Boy.
Survey says.
Wow.
Life.
Oh, that is life. That's what he do. He walked up behind, and they were sitting outside, right?
What were they doing, Gino? Come on, it's life.
They were prisoners.
Yeah,
right.
They were prisoners. He walked up behind them. Was at the table.
Ball head.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Terrible. Woo. That's terrible. Okay.
All right. Look, she gave you like, she kind of said it like in the cadence of the.
Nah, I should have known that line. Mm.
Yeah. No.
One of my favorite movies, actually.
Is it?
I mean, for the two greats to be in a movie like that together? Yeah, absolutely.
Eddie Murphy is just. Okay,
yes,
sorry.
He is.
If you think about the Nutty Professor, though, and all those characters he was playing at that table.
Right. Get into it.
Listen.
Martin, too.
Listen.
I did say it with confidence, though. Like
you did. You was like, baby boy.
Yeah.
Nah. Okay. All right. If she helps you with the cadence of, like, the voice of the character, I ain't gonna do that.
All right, bet.
Marcus, darling, I don't have any panties on.
Okay. So if I had a top 5 films, this would probably be number 4. And this is Boomerang.
Oh, okay. Survey says, ding, 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 ding.
You're correct, all sir. Right. I'll check on that. Okay.
Man, am I going to score after this?
The next one.
Mm-hmm.
They got the golden arches. I got golden arcs. They got the Big Mac. I got the Big Mick.
Coming to America?
Yeah! That's one of my favorite movies.
That's top 3. That's top 3.
No, absolutely.
Like, that's a classic.
Yes, absolutely.
But, yo, he was so confident. Yes. Like, nah, this ain't the same.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yo, because he threw his hands out. He was like, they got the golden arches. Uh-huh. I got the golden arcs.
You see, they got the big.
They got the Big Mac. I got the Big Mick.
Yeah. That was a good time.
Classic.
All right, next one.
Mm-hmm. What's wrong? How y'all laughing before you ask? What's going on in the building?
That word,
what's wrong in the building?
All right, she
okay, sorry. It. Okay.
I'm going to take a sip. Shit.
You want to smell my punani?
Do I want to smell your punani? That's the, hold on. Didn't we just did that movie?
Don't say it again, please.
That's the same movie.
It's Coming to America?
No. Boomerang, right?
Survey says.
Poetic justice.
When she leaned
in the don't tell me that's right there when she was
Where was she at?
When Tupac came in.
Yeah.
And he leaned over. Mm. Or she leaned over.
Yeah.
And Baby Boy's mom, Boys in the Hood mom, leaning over and asking, "Did she?" He said, "No."
No, Janet Jackson.
Janet Jackson said, "You want to smell my punani?" And then she came over and was like, "In his face." Come on,
man. Come on, Poetic Justice.
You said you a filmmaker.
It's like
I know.
My guy, I'm off today.
You are.
What's going on?
Next one.
I'm disappointed.
I know.
All right. Early. See, I'm trying to give it to you in the cadence to make it to
I'm not giving no breaks. Right.
Petty Patty over here.
Petty.
I'm on petty patrol today. All right. I'm on my Remy Ma petty today.
Oh, man, you don't watch that movie.
All right, next one.
Uh-huh.
I am crazy. And you know what else? I don't give... Wait, because it's a typo. It's a typo.
Okay.
It threw me off. It threw me off. All right. I am crazy. And you know what else? I don't give a fuck.
I am. Oh, that's Juice. That's number one.
So we said,
Love Jones, Juice, Coming to America, Boomerang, and Heat.
Yeah. Okay. Next one. It was like his dick just talked to me.
Love Jones.
Yes. What it say, girl?
No, she was like, what it say?
Yes. Yeah.
She was like, Nina.
But she like closed her eyes.
And she was like, yo, her mom was like,
dang. Sorry, I didn't turn my phone off.
Oh, that's your phone.
That's his phone. What? It's been
when you have five network meetings, then, you know, that's what happens.
It's cool.
It's cool.
That's our game time music then.
Right, it is.
All
right,
the next one.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, I'm throwing off. Can we wait for it to end? Yeah. Okay.
Y'all want me to go turn it off?
No, you're good. The next one.
Mm-hmm.
You are a perfect verse over a tight beat. Would you like me to repeat it?
Perfect verse over a tight beat. If I had to guess, I would say that was Brown Sugar.
Woo! Server says ding, 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 ding,
ding, ding, ding, ding, ding. Why you gotta guess that though?
Because I was for sure in the two I got wrong. Like, I was confident. You know what I'm saying? And I can hear
now
this.
Now you coming in with ease.
Yeah,
like,
yeah. So let me be as confident. You do that.
All right, here's the next one. This is like one of my favorites. So if you get this wrong, I'm just going to walk out.
No.
And you'll interview yourself.
Terrible.
All right. Look, you're in college now, which means you have one of two options. Either you play it safe and have an enlightening educational experience, or close your eyes and enjoy the ride.
Wow. That is your line in Black Boots.
Yes. Little trick question throw in there.
Yes. That was said to me. That was real.
Mm. Wow.
That was real. So that's how I could never get that wrong. That was actually a real experience that I pulled from, and you lived it out and played it out for me.
Wow. So the first episode of Black Boots, first mm-hmm. time you see myself and my co-star, Courtney Burrell, shout out to him, who plays Grant, and I play Zoe. Mm-hmm. I am a junior at the school. He's a freshman, and I'm schooling him on how to navigate through college,
and
if
everything
you will.
Else.
And then after that, it gets wild. So check out that first episode. It's a little crazy. And that was written by...
Yes,
Mr. Geno
Brooks. That was me.
Wait, I'm sorry. This is so funny because on here, Michelle hashtagged it.
Yeah. Look, you got to see it to believe it, all right? I hashtag it just like I hashtagged all the other films.
She hashtagged hashtag Black Boots written by hashtag Geno.
Love it.
Yeah, I'm serious. I'll be serious.
Love it.
Okay. I think you got how many right?
Like... One.
I got four out of six right. Yeah.
Okay.
You got Brown Sugar, Love Jones, Black Boots, Juice.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Boomerang. All right. You got most of them.
You're a filmmaker. Okay. You're a filmmaker.
Thank you.
You got your filmmaker card back.
Terrible.
Okay. So next question. Mm-hmm. Oh, my headset. Oh, there we go. Next question.
Yeah.
So in the entertainment industry. At times, from what I understand, like in a famous line I've seen is like, hurry up and wait.
Mm-hmm.
There's a waiting game until you start seeing the fruits of your labor. For example, and I mess up this black man's name.
Mahershala.
Mm-hmm. I call him Fine. That's his name. His name is Fine.
Yeah.
Who just won an Oscar for Moonlight, has been in the game for 16 years, and he was in like House of Cards and all that. And it's just now being acknowledged on this level, in this platform. What do you do to keep yourself encouraged during this season of your career, like during this waiting time?
That's a great question. And what I have to do is, like, what I've learned to do with seeing such great talents come and do their thing, as far as, like, some of my talent to go on and do bigger things, is, like, to kind of pull it back and make sure that, understanding that my season is my season, you know what I mean? And like, really grasping this concept of, you know, like, listen, G, just stick to what you do, work, continue to outwork yourself, and strive to be better than you were yesterday. Mm-hmm. So I'm able to be, I'm cool in knowing that every day I'm pushing the needle forward towards my moment, mm-hmm. you know, because I have dreams of winning an Oscar and an Emmy, you know. Mm-hmm. So it'll come. I'm very confident in it, you know. I just can't, what I had to do is get out of my way and stop, not comparing, because it was never comparing. It's just like, thinking their time is my time.
Yeah.
So once I was able to do that, it's cool. Cause mm-hmm. You know, I'm gonna keep working.
Absolutely. And you yeah. said your first script that you wrote was 2010.
Yeah.
So it was just 7 years ago. I don't want to say just, but
yeah.
That's
a small amount of time, though.
That's a small amount of time if you think about yeah. how long, you know. It most people, like he said, 16 years.
Yeah.
And not just 16 years of like, oh, I'm just like working. He's yeah. been working. Like, you know what I'm saying? Absolutely. So it's.
That's, and the funny thing is, I ran into Barry Jenkins. I know him.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, yeah. Not like know him, like I can call him. Right. But just where he's a member of the Writers Guild. And I remember like 2 years ago, they had this like meet and greet. And he was just there. He's kind of a quiet guy. Mm-hmm. I learned that he was an alpha. So that was our connection. Mm-hmm. And we spoke. And I was just like, man, what's going on? How, you know, because I was like a buddy. I just got into the WGA. He's like, man, to be honest with you, I've been mostly directing. I was like, but you're here at the Writers Guild. He was like, yeah, I'm kind of get working my muscle back out, and I'm working on some things now. That was 2 years ago at a WGA event. And then the next event I saw him at was a NAACP like Image Awards thing, mm-hmm. and he was in a crowd with me. And then a month ago I went, and he was on the panel, and he said that. And then when I spoke to him afterwards, he was like, "Yo, G, you remember those? You remember that day, right?" I was like, "Yeah." He says, "Just hold fast." Mm-hmm. So for stuff like that, for reasons like that, I won't cheat the process.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. That's real. And it's just something about when you know you worked so hard, when you get it, you just be like,
yeah.
Ooh, Jesus.
It's hard.
Yeah, it is.
It's definitely
hard
to feel like you have the talent to be on, but you haven't had your light shined on you yet. But, you know, I'm dope. And when I come, I'll have, the great thing about me is I'm not a one-hit wonder. You know, I feel like I have a faucet of ideas and concepts to kind of come along mm-hmm. after I get my moment. You know, one of my people I really look to is Jay-Z. You know, he's a Sagittarius like I am. And it took time.
Yeah.
You know, so.
That's what's up. Absolutely. excuse me, I don't know what's going on. What director, writer, producer has influenced you the most and why?
It's crazy because it's like I would say Spike, just because of like the visuals and things of that sort. That's the kind of the first black filmmaker that I knew of. Mm-hmm. Although of course he wasn't the first one, but it was the first person that my uncle set me down, was like, yo, watch this.
Right.
You know what I mean? And to kind of see everything that he's been able to do throughout his career, has really put an emphasis on how I tell my stories and lay my things out. So I say Spike overall, but somebody that's like, their story inspires me, F. Gary Gray is a director that I really look to, that can kind of handle big budget concepts, because I want to be able to do the noir films, or, you know, the more like personal indie films, if you will. But I also want to speak to the blockbusters, and I think he does a great job of doing both.
That's real. Mm-hmm. That's definitely real.
So you cast pretty often.
Yeah.
What are some mistakes you see actors and actresses make in auditions?
Screaming. Yeah.
Like when they get a line, they like, "Hi, my name is."
Yeah.
Like that. Time.
It's just like everything isn't, you know, for me. I what I like to, you know, sometimes it might play out too long. Like I just watched that clip you know, as a director, I'm looking at it was a couple beats too long, but it felt right when I was there. I want things to kind of, I want people to feel moments before they release. It's not about what's on page. It's, for me, it's always about connection with who and you're talking to and who's going to be receiving it. So a lot of times people just play and play to the words and not concentrate on the connection with the person or the person they're auditioning for or the person that's in scene with them. You can see it in their eyes if they're really there.
Yeah.
Right. That's definitely real.
So screaming is one of them. Chill that out. You don't got to scream at it.
And screaming also, I think also too, in the sense of like if it's an angry scene where you're supposed to be upset or, you know, a lot of times if you look at human nature, when people are upset, a lot of times they're actually more quiet because they're trying to figure out what they even want to like say and get out at times. You know what I'm saying?
And I love that. I mean, that's what I look for, the beauty in that, because I can cut around it. If it's too, if it takes you a little longer than it should, I can feel it and cut around it in the, in post. But I don't want to rush you to get there. So, you know, I love for my characters and my actors to kind of take their time to get to where they have to be. Because I can go, I can cut to somebody's reaction while you're trying to get there.
Right. That's real. Definitely, bro. Oh, listen, you are it, sir. Your phone is dinging. It is like you are. I can see you. He's on. Look, y'all better catch him now. It was too late.
My apologies for my phone.
Yeah, that's all good. You are. You pop. You in the building. So we get it. You know what I mean? We're happy we could just
prove to the viewers that it's real.
Yeah, we're happy we could snag just an hour of your time.
You truly are.
We truly are. Okay, so what advice would you give to young filmmakers who want to do what you're doing? At this moment, like, what do you think they should be doing, you know, to lead up to even where you are right now?
First things first, is build yourself a team with people that love to do what they do. Okay. If you're a director, then concentrate on directing. You don't necessarily have to write it, you know. I get some writers or get them an opportunity to write it, you know, because everybody can't write. That's what I've learned. So if you're a writer, get a director to act and direct it out, unless you call yourself or want to work on those two muscles. But I just feel like people have to put themselves around people that have the same energy that they want, they have to get to where they're trying to go, put them in the same room, and get a team of people with those, you know, then, and you look at each other like resources. I look at Michelle like, you know, although she's my friend, I look at it as a resource. Mm-hmm. She's doing her thing now, right? I'm still doing my thing. I have goals in my head that play out 5-10 years from now when I have a budget to do a feature. You see what I'm saying? So you kind of got to know and utilize your relationships, your talent in the best way possible. And if you put something out and you don't allow for the better talents of other people, you know, to kind of come along, then you're playing yourself because that's that digital stuff is out there for a while.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Just floats out in the atmosphere.
Yeah. And it's harder to take something bad back than it is to take something pretty good back that took a little bit more time to do.
That's all very true.
Yeah. Absolutely. And I mean, and to your point too, I think what I'm realizing more than anything, because I have aspirations of producing, and I told you about the silent film I'm working on now and things like that, and it's just, I already was like, hey, so you want to like help me direct this? Like, because it's important to like lean on people, you know, that you need. Or even when we were talking about like the set here, we were like, you know, Jeanine, this is what she do. So it's like, yo, can you figure out how we want this to look? Or it's important that you, you know, it takes a village. It really does take a village.
Absolutely. And then like, y'all agree on where y'all trying to go, outline those goals together, and then help each other reach those points, you know. And I think that's kind of helped. That's kind of, that is what helped me get to where I am. And, you know, that's why I'm trying to give opportunities for others.
Nice. Okay. So can you talk to us about, this new show? We're going to show a clip from it called Off the Track.
Oh yeah. Love it.
Do you want to talk about it? Or do you want to talk about it? Let's watch it first. Okay. Let's watch it. And then we're going to come back and you tell us what did we just see?
Okay. And Jazz, you forget something? Come here.
to do this for the rest of my life.
Completely different tone from what we saw earlier. Yeah. So speak to us a little bit about Off the Track.
It's definitely a different tone from what I did earlier. It's about showing your right, your, what you can do as a filmmaker, the versatility, making sure that certain images are told, certain stories are told. And as a social, you know, as a social worker in Compton, I saw a lot of things, right? Because that's kind of what I've been doing. That's how I make my living outside of what I'm doing, right? And one of the things is, I remember a story that one of my coworkers told me about this foster care kid running away, right? And they found out where she was a few years later, and she was on the prostitution track. Okay. So what I wanted to do, this is off the, take a break a little bit. Off the Track is about four women living on and off the prostitution track, right? It sounds a little bit vulgar. But my attempt in telling the story is to change the narrative of how you think of prostitution, to understand the reasonings that they make certain choices, to understand their psyche and how, why they can't get off this track, what are their aspirations to try to get off of it, and if they could, like, how do they dream? You know, are they somebody that wants to be an entrepreneur? What does that look like? So I just wanted to make sure, you know, like I said, tying in with a little bit of foster care and how that got, how these people got to that situation, and telling that story, you know, the oldest trick, the oldest profession in the book has never been told quite like this.
Yeah. Mm.
You know, and that's what I really wanted to do. And that stars Tanisha Howard, which I feel like is next out of my group.
She's
of
brilliant.
Batch.
Yeah, she's brilliant.
If you will, like, you know, a batch of talent. I feel like she hasn't had her moment yet. I mean, she has, but I wanted to give her a platform to kind of, to soar. Mm-hmm. And again, this story was already inside me, but it took that character, it took that talent that I had, that I was reserved, because she's starring in it, to be the vehicle for it.
Yeah.
And again, that goes back to how I, you know, I got to get inspired by someone or something.
Yeah.
And when I had that something, I had to find that someone. And she agreed to do it, which I'm grateful for and I love her for.
Yeah. Shout out to Tanedra.
Hey, Tanedra, girl.
Girl, you're amazing and you're funny as hell, too.
Yeah.
Well, Geno,
we want to really thank you for being here. We really appreciate it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
It's been great.
Truly.
It's been a phenomenal time. Inspiring.
Hey.
I'm happy for you. Look at
you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Ladies, thank you again. I'm truly proud of y'all for where y'all have gone so far and where y'all going.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Where can
everyone
find you? Can you just drop your social media handles as well as your network channel on YouTube?
Thank you so much. You can find me personally at Geno Brooks TV. That's G-E-N-O Brooks TV. You can find and that's all on every social media, from Periscope to Twitter to everything. And then for the Artistic Standard, which is our network, you can find us on YouTube at the Artistic Standard TV, and Artistic Standard TV on YouTube, Twitter. I mean, not YouTube, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. Make sure you like us. Oh, and then last thing, if you want to subscribe, if you want to support and see that these see more stories like this, you know, because a lot of the funds that go to that is helping us produce these projects. There's really no way to say it other than, you know, help us tell these stories. And you can find us at artisticstandardtv.vhx.tv.
Wonderful.
Yeah. Well, I am Michelle Mitchenor. That is Michelle with two L's, and Mitchenor, M-I-T-C-H-E-N-O-R. That is on all social platforms.
I am Moments _ Matter. Why?
Because they do.
And I'm Quinny from Philly.
And I'm Quinny from Philly. You can find me on Instagram at Quinny from Philly.
QinnyFrmPhilly.
23rd in Somerset.
Thank y'all so much for tuning in to On The Come Up. And we'll be back next week again. We appreciate y'all for tuning in. See you next week. Mwah, mwah, mwah.